Welcome. My name is Stephen Dana. I'm the dean of the SUNY Plattsburgh at Queensbury Branch Campus. In case you didn't know, SUNY Plattsburgh has a Queensbury campus right next door. But you are in the beautiful Northwest Bay Conference Center that SUNY Adirondack built, in addition to some other spectacular facilities. We have an outstanding community college and an outstanding partnership with SUNY Plattsburgh at Queensbury and SUNY Adirondack. So knowledge is power. That's what Francis Bacon said. And tonight, you have the chance to leave empowered to choose the next 21st congressional district candidate who will serve our region. The stakes are high. You're here because you care about the environment. You're here because you're concerned about climate change. Perhaps you're here for your grandchildren or for your future generations. Regardless, this is an important evening. And it is sponsored by North Country Climate Reality. And you had on your seats, and I hope you tucked it in your pockets, a little square flyer that describes North Country Climate Reality. NCCR was founded 5 years ago to support individual and community climate solutions. We meet bi-monthly, 5 to 8 p.m. with food, right next door, and we strategize and brainstorm and converse about solutions, hope. This is the outcome of one of those sessions. Julie Walsh and Dana Stimson, where is Julie and Dana? Please stand up. Where are you, Julie? Let's give them a big hand. At one of our meetings said, you know, Steve, we should have a Meet the Candidates environmental forum. And that was 4 months ago. And here we are today. And then we needed a moderator. We needed someone who had the savvy and everything it took to moderate a panel of distinguished guests. And that's where Dr. Bill Troop comes in. Bill, right here. On the table, we have Bill. But before I do so, I also want to recognize our committee, the NCCR committee, if you will. Assistant to the Dean, Michelle Howland. You may also know Michelle as singer of Juxtapose, the beautiful environmental songs that they sing at our annual conferences, and also the songs they sing at their different places they sing at in the region. Also, a former member, founding member, Patrick Nelson, who happens to be right there. Our new member, Dr. Linda Fusco, right there in the back. There you go. And of course, Bill Troop. So I'm going to tell you about Bill and then I'm going to stop. So Bill is professor of environmental studies at Green Mountain College. He was a provost there for 12 years and he still has all his hair. I don't know how he did it, but he was a provost and then he returned to the faculty. He served for 6 years on the board of directors of the Association for the Advancement of Sustainability in Higher Education. He is involved in too many environmental projects to list right now. He is working on a book, though, titled Flourishing Amid the Age of Climate Change, Finding the Heart of Sustainability. And personally, one of the things I love about Bill is that he's filled with hope and he inspires. And he moves cynicism out of the picture because there are solutions. So with that, let's go from here.
I think we're going to hear about hope tonight and solutions. So I'm going to be very brief because these are the folks you want to hear from. But I want to first thank you all for coming out to this. It's clear that environmental issues matter a great deal in the North Country. And I want to thank you for all of the questions you've submitted. We've done our very best to package them, put them together, so that the candidates have an opportunity to address them. They won't get to all of them, of course. I also want to have a big thank you for our candidates for having the courage and stamina to run for office. We need more people. And we really appreciate your being here to share your knowledge and your wisdom. So we've designed this forum to maximize the candidates' opportunity to share their perspectives on key environmental issues in short statements, and to comment on the views of each other as they choose. So here's the format. It's a little complicated, but not too complicated. They're gonna get it. First, they each have a 2-minute opportunity to introduce themselves. Not necessarily about the environment, just their candidacy. Then we'll have pairs of questions and follow-ups on particular topics regarding environmental issues. And on the first question, the primary question, each candidate will have up to 2 minutes to respond to the question. They also will have the option to pass or to briefly agree with someone else, and then to bank their time for the follow-up question. And in the follow-up round, they'll either have a 30-second sound bite, 30 seconds, or if they bank their time, they'll have 90 seconds. So you know, you can say, I think I'm gonna wait to deliver my powerful response on the follow-up round. They can also pass on the follow-up. So we've asked the candidates to be position-focused with their answers and to express disagreements with respect. Now, the order of responses is going to be, comes from a random number generator, but it's been adjusted to make sure each candidate gets a good shot at first or second responses. And we've really tried to make this as fair as we possibly can. We're going to have a new topic and pairs of questions, and we're going to go till 8. The hardest job in this forum is keeping time. And we have a great timekeeper. I want to thank Don Franks, who will keep track of the candidates' time. Don? And let them know with a yellow card, 15 seconds. He's got other cards, but that's the crucial one. And with a red card, when time is up. And when time is up, I will have politely, but firmly, cut people off. And so we're fair with everyone. Okay, we're not going to take questions from the audience. We got your questions. We're going to do our best to put them in, and we're going to end as close to 8 as we can. So with that, it's time to hear from our candidates, and the introductions go in alphabetical order, starting with Don.
Well, first off, I want you guys to all give yourselves a round of applause, please, because environmental issues cannot be deprioritized any longer. There's so much going on in the world. There's so many things. We cannot forget about these issues. So give yourselves a round of applause. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Don Boyaj, and I live in Cambridge in Washington County, and I'm an environmental attorney in upstate New York. And it's really interesting coming off of Earth Day, and I want to call upon all the candidates, all of our electeds in Albany and D.C. to remember that Earth Day is just one day a year for so many people. It should be 365 days a year. Earth Day is every day. That's what it is for me as an environmental attorney. I've dedicated my life to this. Growing up here in upstate New York, going to school to study environmental geography, and going to forestry graduate studies, becoming an environmental attorney after working on environmental policy in Congress. I'm representing communities every day that are suffering the plight of years and years of corporate industrial abuse, representing communities along the Hudson River. We used to get our drinking water out of the Hudson. I hear stories from my father about swimming in the Hudson as a kid, not knowing any better. It's ridiculous. We've been through so much, and I am just, I'm outraged by this current administration. It is dangerous and it is radical. what they're doing with respect to environmental policy. They're attacking clean water, they're attacking clean air, they're attacking the very policies that I've spent my life living in, breathing in. They have saved our communities. And that's why I'm running for Congress. I'm running to protect the Clean Air Act. I'm running to protect the Clean Water Act and ensure that all of our industrial abuses get finished, get cleaned up. That's why I'm running for Congress, so that our kids have clean air and water. Thank you.
SUNY Potsdam, and I set my roots in the North Country, and for 10 years I lived off the grid with my husband. He is a solar installer, and we power our car with our solar panels. We have a Chevy Volt. So to me, giving speeches is easy, but living our lives every day is difficult, and living our environmental values sometimes is difficult. As a legislator, a county legislator, I was able to vote on legislation regarding the environment. With my colleagues, we beat a company called Bion, which was going to build an 84,000 cow contained animal feeding operation on the St. Lawrence River. That's why elections matter. That's why local elections matter. That's why national elections matter. And I want you to know, you have an incinerator here. I got involved in local politics as a college student to beat the incinerator in St. Lawrence County. We beat it. So right now, we have to face the reality of elections, and that we must beat Elise Stefanik. And I am hoping that you will have faith in me that I can do that so that we can set ourselves back on track. Thank you.
I'm Dr. Lynn Kahn. I am the Green Party candidate for Congress in District 21. I want to thank the organizers for inviting an independent third-party candidate. Usually we're left out. I'm not part of the food fight. I will be on the ballot in November. I came to upstate New York every summer as a child. My father would put us all in the car, drive up from New York City. We'd drive somewhere up here, it would take a few hundred miles. And this is where I learned what clean air smells like, what clean water tastes like. I learned to hike, I learned to swim, I felt grounded. And decades later, this is where I brought my son so he would have the same kinds of experiences until we were able to buy a small house in Essex County 15 years ago. My degree is in clinical psychology, but I worked as an organizational change agent inside the federal government for 32 years. And I am committed and passionate about doing something about how broken and dysfunctional and wasteful our government agencies are. My parents grew up in the same orphanage. My mom and her two sisters, my dad and his brother, all in the same orphan asylum. So I have been driven my entire life to figure out all the things that I didn't know and that I didn't know that I didn't know. I've been driven to figure out about people and institutions. And when I started working inside the federal government, I did that kind of work from team building to looking at how agencies operate, how they connect or don't connect, about all the waste. In the 1990s, I was for 6.5 years on the White House Partnership to Reinvent Government. So I get the executive branch of government, and I know we're all running for Congress, but the solutions are how the legislative branch and the executive branch work together to implement solutions.
Thank you. There used to be a time in our country and in our region when 40 hours of hard work paid you enough so that you could put food on your table and so that you could put some money away for retirement and maybe your children's education. But now we know in our district that 40 hours a week is often not enough. People are struggling to put the food on their table and certainly can't save for retirement. And so this race, to me, is about returning to our country that value that hard work is rewarded. It's about making sure that all people matter in our economy. And it's about making sure that everyone has a chance to realize their full potential. And it's from this that come the visions that I have for our district. One of them being 10 to 20 years from now, graduating seniors can stay or go depending on where they want to live, not whether they can find a job. It's the vision that 10 to 20 years from now, our rural region can be the model of revival for other rural regions. And inside of that is embedded the clean energy economy. We have the power in our district to teach other rural areas what an economy based on clean energy looks like. And I look forward to telling you more about my experience with that from the questions. So between my public service volunteer work with transitional housing and community meals and my over 20 years in business, most recently in the economic development region, I know that I can not only unseat Elise Stefanik, but move our district in that direction and realize these visions. Thank you very much.
Mic check. Good evening, everyone. My name is Patrick Nelson, and I'm here today from the small town of Stillwater, New York, along the banks of the Hudson River. I grew up in what is now an EPA Superfund site. For the first 18 years of my life, due to corporate irresponsibility from General Electric, myself and the other residents of the town and village of Stillwater, unbeknownst to us, drank water contaminated with PCBs. So environmental issues are incredibly important and personal to me in my life. I'm running for Congress because we have some very important decisions to make in the coming decades. We need to transition our energy systems from fossil fuel to renewable energy as quickly as humanly possible. I can't stress that enough. We are at a crisis tipping point in terms of our environment. If we do not make bold, responsible decisions very quickly, the creature comforts that we take for granted, our society and our very way of life are under threat. Our national security is under threat. Our economy is under threat. We talk a lot about a lot of issues throughout this campaign. But you have the greatest healthcare system in the world. If we do not take care of our environment, it's not going to matter. So this is a linchpin issue for the human race. And it comes back to something else that's tremendously important. There's a bottleneck in getting any work done in our government right now, and it's our corrupt electoral and campaign finance systems that have allowed the same people that told you that tobacco smoke didn't cause cancer to now go work as lobbyists for the fossil fuel industry, peddling the same kind of anti-science rhetoric that is harming our country, is harming our planet, and it has to stop, and it has to stop now. Thank you.
Bloomberg as a journalist, and then CNBC. and at the height of the financial crisis, was at a front row seat to see how his ideal idea of what America was crumbled beneath him, how things were fixed in ways that he had not realized before, and how that a lot of people who had consolidated money and power really took away from the ability for all Americans to actually have fair opportunity and well-being in this country. When he transitioned to MSNBC, he tried to dig more into politics, and he ended up leaving there as well because he wanted to work towards something bigger than that. When he left, he had started the Get Money Out movement, which accrued several hundred thousand people nationwide, and he also invested most of his life savings into Helical Holdings, which worked to make small-scale solar-powered grid farming kits that can produce clean water, electricity, internet, and food. And this was just one way he thought that he could start contributing toward creating a better world for everyone around us. He is now here, been back in Lake Placid, living there for the last 6 years in New York 21, and he's here hoping to have the opportunity to represent the district and bring a lot of his ideas and his knowledge to help work with everyone in here and show that together, though our political system is broken, everyone can come together to fix this.
There was a full moon. It was the middle of the night, and I pitched a tent, and I tried to sleep. But I woke up many times to the sound of chanting and ceremony and prayer. The next morning I awoke, and I popped my head up in the tent, and I saw a little boy standing on the back of a pickup truck in front of a teepee, looking like this across the field that everyone was camped out in. And up on the ridge were men on horseback, bareback, painted ponies, like something out of a movie. And so my friend and I walked down to the river where women were praying and holding ceremony, dumping the waters that they had collected from people across the country into their water source, fighting and praying in their own best way for a brighter future for not just their children, but all children. Bald eagles flying over. Right here in New York 21, almost 20% of children live below the poverty line. The average income per capita in the North Country is only $27,000 a year. That is not enough. It's not enough to survive on. And those numbers keep people from doing more about these larger issues because they're stuck in survival mode. And that is what I want to talk about tonight. What are the solutions, and how do we turn this around so that we can not only fight for our own children, but for all the future generations to come? Thank you.
All right, the first question. It's a warm up. They've already warmed up, so they're really ready to go. So here it is. How do you understand the role of government in addressing environmental issues? And what are the top three environmental issues, either global or regional, that you think require action by the U.S. Congress? Why those three and not others? And we're starting. Yes. Very good.
Am I on? Yes. Good. All right. So I'm going to say what my three issues are, and then I'm going to go back to talking about how you actually solve problems. My three issues are clean water, the anti-science attack on the truth that's happening, and this lovely little phrase I learned at your conference a week ago Friday, eco-anxiety. So, after, I think I said I was on the White House Partnership to Reinvent Government for 6.5 years. I went back to the Federal Aviation Administration and got to work on the strategic plan that brought together seven different government agencies and all the stakeholders, like airlines and manufacturers and runways, to modernize our airspace system. And this is what I learned. I learned about the power of a plain language strategic plan with roadmaps and timelines that bring people together to move forward as a network, not just a team, but a network. And I took that model into the work that I'm now doing in justice reform. So I took that model into transforming a citywide agency that wanted to change juvenile services. And then in New York City, with the commissioner, wanted to transform probation. And earlier this year, with the office that wanted to transform the relationship across all criminal justice agencies and all neighborhood groups. So in dealing with an issue like water, or any of the issues that any of us talk about, and I think we all agree on almost all of them, it's important to think through, all right, we want clean water, of course. What are the different chunks? What are the different parts to that problem? And how do we divide that up and put that into one plan that everybody can agree on and move forward with? And gotta be honest, I just blows my mind. I just heard NASA wants to turn off the cameras that face the Earth in their distant weather satellite system.
I'm sorry, Dr. Kahn.
Not gonna help. It's not gonna help.
Thank you very much.
Miss Silla. So as someone who grew up here in this incredibly beautiful, you know, dripping with natural beauty environment, I know what it's like to identify and be formed by my environment. And I think most of the people in this room do too, and most people across this region. But our environment is also very much the economic engine.
You can't hear.
Is this better? So we're formed by our environment here, and we're informed by it. And we're also very aware that it's the economic driver behind tourism and so many of the things we rely upon. We know that it's real, not just you and I, but the farmers and the loggers. Everyone knows that the climate change is happening, whether or not they agree on who's causing it. It threatens our livelihood and our future. Now, the three areas that I really identify needing to address right now are health, our economy and jobs, and future generations. And right now, we all know that we need clean air and water, but when I look around at some of the effects of climate change, I see Lyme disease as a huge issue right now. We must fund studies through the CDC to enable correct diagnoses and then make sure that insurance companies are actually providing care. It is bankrupting families. My own son was in tears the other night after coming out of the woods, so scared that he was gonna have ticks all over him, which we found some, and end up with Lyme disease like his grandmother. I mean, it's terrifying children from being able to go into the woods. It's a crisis. Now, in terms of jobs, the DOE is responsible for funding and regulating initiatives and incentives to make sure we can transition to a clean jobs economy. Solar Vets program, great program. At Clinton Community College, they are training wind turbine technicians, which is the fastest growing job sector. And just to wrap this up so I don't get cut off, we have to protect our future generations, and that's clean air and water, it's a carbon tax. Thank you.
Okay, so the first part of the question is role of government, and I see the role of government has two things. One, the government protects us, or should, protects us when we cannot protect ourselves. And the other role, and I think this is where sometimes Democrats, and I would venture to say Green Party, people, is that we see that government solves problems. Government is not the problem. That's important, because right now we have to solve our problem, the problems that face us in the environment. And one of them is clearly global warming. We have to talk about global warming, we have to be clear about global warming, and we have to come up with solutions to that, whether it's legislation and changes in our behavior. We also, I think, need to face the fact that science is important and that it's not a belief, it is. We don't believe in science, it is. And so we have legislation that could pass if we had power, okay? So we need to talk about that, legislation that would allow science to be on the forefront. The Scientific Integrity Act, which Paul Tongo is one of the leaders of, which, by the way, cannot pass because we do not have the power in the House and the Senate and the presidency, right? So that's the other thing we need. And the last thing is we need to invest in the future, the jobs in the future, the technology in the future, agriculture, right? Wind, solar, biotechnology that will help us in the future. Those are the things that I think we need to invest in. The problems, again, circling back to what is the role of government, the problems that we must solve.
Three biggest issues as climate change, acid rain, and invasive species. And I think that the government should take a leading role on this because the government is charged with protecting our life, liberty, and our pursuit of happiness. And I think we should do that by creating partnerships at the federal level with our local governments. And I think we should focus on public-private partnerships. I know they work. The state has been doing a darn good job between NYSERDA and banning fracking within New York State. The federal government, on the other hand, thanks to the GOP leaders, as well as Elise Stefanik, who when push comes to shove, she will side with Paul Ryan and the GOP agenda every time against us. There are regulations that are helping New York 21 prevent acid rain. And she is diminishing those protections. So I, on the other hand, during this whole time she's been in Washington, have been working within our district with a leading economic development organization to implement that economy based on clean energy. So I know it works. One example is we helped secure funding for public businesses who wanted to energy retrofit, to save on fossil fuels and heating costs, one of those being the Hotel Saranac. In Saranac Lake. Another project is that we know that municipalities are strapped for staff and cash, and so we hired some people to help municipalities start projects that will make them more energy efficient. And this means they're going to be hiring people within the private sector to do those energy retrofits, which means then that once they're done, they're saving taxpayer money. They can either be saved and not taxed, or it can go into other important projects. So that's one example of how public-private partnerships working with local government works.
I'm sorry, I'm trying to get to these. And you know, the first part of the question, the role of the government in addressing environmental issues. Well, let me tell you what. Clean air does not see state borders. Water does not see state borders. Climate change does not see any boundaries at all. That's why, precisely why, the federal government is the most important actor in addressing environmental issues, because they don't see boundaries. That's something that we forget all the time. And I'll tell you what I don't want to repeat what they said, but number one, Scott Pruitt. That's the biggest environmental issue in the country right now. Saved our region. And we have a Representative Stefanik. You're voting to roll back the Clean Air Act and you supposedly represent the Adirondacks? The Clean Air Act saved us from acid rain. Does she have a clue?
No.
Now, there's another issue because I don't want to repeat what they're all great points. But the Superfund Act. I live my life in this realm. We all do along the Hudson River. I represented communities that used to get their drinking water out of the Hudson. I represented the Mohawks up at Akwesasne. They were eating fish out of the river for decades, contaminated with incredibly high levels of PCB. Guess what? Very high cancer rates. 230,000 people actually die every year from half exposure to chemicals in the environment. So why do I bring up the Superfund? The fact is the Superfund is empty. It was a trust fund set up to do cleanups. Look at our cleanup on the Hudson River. It's not done, it's half done. They said when they did this cleanup that we would be able to eat fish after dredging within 7 years. Now they're saying 54 years, I think. Does that sound like a done job? If you went and you had to clean up your room as a kid and you only clean up 20% of it, will your parents be happy? No. Well, the truth is we need federal money to finish these cleanups. The health of our communities depend upon it. And that's why I'm running for Congress. I want to make sure that the federal funds are in place to finish the job. Thank you.
No issue better demonstrates our broken politics than the great shift we need to implement in response to environmental necessities. Instead, our politics, in exchange for campaign cash, continue to subsidize a failed and destructive status quo. We need to address our destructive energy systems, the centralization of profit with the resulting destruction of local economies, and degenerative agricultural systems. In addressing these issues, for the last half decade, I invested in and founded Helical Holdings, which produces solar-powered hydroponic greenhouses capable of producing electricity, internet access, clean water, and food. We must focus on creating more localized, renewable energy systems and revitalizing local economies and agriculture.
An enviable position of going last on this one. So the role of the government is twofold. Number one, it's setting goals and placing the incentives on the system to meet those goals. And number two, it's providing the emotional leadership that we need to convince ourselves that we actually can solve this problem because it is a daunting task. We need the kind of leadership that we saw when Jack Kennedy stood on the field at Rice University and proclaimed that we would go to the moon within the end of the decade. Now, there were no guarantees that was going to work, but we set that high water mark and we hit it because we had leadership. So in that way, I say we choose to rise to the challenge of climate change and do the other things, not because they're easy, but because they are hard, because that goal will serve to test the best of our knowledge and energy, because that challenge is one that we are willing to accept, one that we are unwilling to postpone, and one that we intend to win, and the others as well. And I say that just to remind you what a president of the United States is supposed to sound like. Now, there are a lot of good things. Climate change is a huge issue. There's three parts of climate change we have to address. That's mitigation, adaptation, and innovation. We'll come back to that a little bit later. We have to deal with a disposable society. We're generating a lot of trash. And we have a garbage patch in the Pacific Ocean the size of the state of Texas, conservatively speaking. So it's not just climate change. What this is going to do to our food chain is potentially disastrous and destructive. So we have to deal with that, like the thin film plastic bags and those other areas. But the most important thing that hasn't been talked about by anyone tonight is environmental justice. And environmental justice is saying that if you live in the same neighborhood as your congressperson or the person that writes them a $2,700 check, you probably don't live on a Superfund site. You probably don't face the consequences of pollution. We concentrate the benefits in wealthy communities, and we concentrate the drawbacks in unwealthy communities. To put this into context, Native American reservations are 4% of the land in the United States. They are 25% of the Superfund sites, and that includes two Superfund sites and the Akwesasne Reservation here in the 21st District.
Thank you.
Either response to each other, or you can address the following follow-up question, or you can pass. If you think your priorities for the environment differ from those of others in the 21st Congressional District, explain the difference and how you would address the issues that you think others have that you haven't mentioned.
Okay, thank you. I think actually I'll use this time to
ask a question. And I'm sorry that Mr. Radigan isn't here to accept the question, but perhaps you'll take it back to him. And that is, why did you start the Gila Corps outside of this district? It's based on solar, veterans, and farmers. Guess what we have an abundance of? Solar, veterans, and farmers. It is hard to start those businesses here, but Apex Solar did it and is thriving. Aztec did it and is thriving. Adirondack Solar Battery did it and they are thriving.
I want to say something about the role of government. And you'd think that I worked inside as a psychologist for 32 years, I'd be, oh yeah, government. And I was an independent candidate for president in 2015 and 2016. I was on the road 20 months, 70,000 miles. There's an enormous amount of pain and damage around this country and in this district, most of which is caused by bad government policy. So I'll say more the next time.
I think that everyone has very good viewpoints up here. And I think that Dylan would say the exact same thing in terms of Gila Coal. All I know is that he did partner with a farm in California to help train and employ veterans. And when he did start the company, he had said, imagine if we were dropping these in countries instead of bombs to actually produce assistance and education and resources for so many people around the world. Can't speak to the specific question, but that is kind of part of the broader idea of what the company's about.
So one of the things is, I'm not gonna do the typical political thing and pretend that a carbon tax or price on carbon is a magic bullet, it's not. I'm the only one in this field now that Ron Kim has left that has signed on with the Off Fossil Fuels Pledge to co-sponsor the Off Fossil Fuels for a Better Future Act. That's HR 3671, has 33 co-sponsors in the House of Representatives, and says we get off fossil fuels by 2035. And it does throw up, so not with a carbon tax, but more generally speaking, with supply side restrictions and the end of subsidies. So the carbon tax, if you were to open a natural gas plant, they would say, okay, open it, here's the additional tax you're gonna pay. Supply side restriction says, I wanna open up a natural gas plant, and we say, no.
And that is when I referred to the facts of science, and I wrote this down. You know, making speeches is easy. We cannot pass the legislation of off fossil fuels until we win this election, and until we win the Senate, and until we win the presidency. We have to be pragmatic. We have to face the reality that we can set lofty goals, but the role of government is to implement those because we have people in the right place at the right time. And that's where we are right now.
I just want to make one quick point. We're going to have an intelligent discussion about these issues. It really makes my blood boil. Stop calling it global warming. I heard a couple people call it global warming. You want to know why we're losing on the issue? Because we keep calling it global warming. It's climate change. It's about volatility, it's about intensity and severity and unpredictability. So if we're gonna talk about this rooted in science, it's about climate change. That's all I wanna say.
I really don't think many of our priorities are too different on this, at least of the people in this room. But what I'm gonna highlight is what I've actually been able to get done before even running for Congress. And that was to help in the Standing Rock movement run a divestment campaign that was incredibly successful worldwide, and also help lead the effort to get those rusty rail cars full of toxicity out of the Adirondack Park.
Well, we've started to talk about climate change. Let's dive in. The U.S. Department of Defense says that climate change is a serious national security issue. There are two main types of security threats. One is the threat of weakening our military strength. Rising sea waters are already threatening key facilities in many of our U.S. naval bases, including our largest naval base in Norfolk, Virginia. The other type of threat is by making the world a more dangerous place, by increasing the number and scale of violent conflicts fought over dwindling resources such as land and water, and by forcing people off their land and onto someone else's. Our nation may be drawn into such conflicts, including our troops in Fort Drum, and resulting wars can provide fertile recruiting grounds for radical groups. Please tell us how you understand the role of climate change in compromising our national security and how you would act in Congress to make us more resilient to the security issues that climate change is likely to cause.
That's me first.
We are at John.
Is this a question number two?
Yes.
Oh, question two.
I got lost. I'm so worked up over this stuff. It's just, if you can't tell, this is kind of my, what I've really lived my life in. And climate change, and I got very worked up when we were talking about the language of it. And there's a very important thing that I want to drive down that I wish the whole country would do when we're championing these issues. Because when we're talking about climate change, it's very easy to put it on the back burner. But there's a much simpler message. It's a threat not just to the environment, it's a threat to our local economy. It's a threat to our human health. It's also a threat to national security. It's a very smart point, and I've been digging into this quite a bit recently. So there's two sides to this. What can we do to our folks in the military to prepare them for this? We need to give them the resources, whether it's infrastructure-based changes that they're going to have to make to their military bases, due to rising sea levels or otherwise. There's a very tight tie between climate change and infrastructure. We need to create resilient infrastructure that's going to adapt, and that particularly relates to our military. They need to be strong and sound. With respect to the second component, increased volatility, conflicts around the world, well, I say why don't we get on top of addressing climate change and try to curb some of the effects. That's really what we should be doing, because it's an inevitability, we're living in it, and a lot of people, it's like the ostrich head in the sand thing. Oh, we're going to be living with climate change. A certain extent of that is true. But if we get on top of it, we can lessen these impacts, and that will decrease the likelihood of engaging in climate-based conflicts in the future. Thank you.
All right, I got a couple things to say. First of all, I don't believe the Department of Department of Defense is allowed to say that climate change is a national security issue anymore. It's like, you know, sustainability or resilience. You're not allowed to use that phrase too much, even though of course it is. What I want to say is don't believe the lies and the myths. The Department of Defense has so much money that's wasted inside its budget, and that's separate from whether or not we ought to be bombing the heck out of places where we have no business dropping bombs and doing drone attacks. And we have killed 4 to 6.5 million civilians in the Mideast, and it's time to stop. And when I talk about how you actually make real change in the real world, you have to understand that things are connected. So the damage we're doing to our planet and our environment here in District 21, poverty, which is way worse than we really understand. I actually agree with some of Tetra's analysis. Whatever number you hear about poverty in District 21, double it. It's 20%, 40% of our adults. It's 40% of our children. In my school district, 70% of the kids are on free and reduced lunch. Poverty is a horrible issue up here, as is domestic violence, as is opioid addiction, as is the lack of good paying jobs, and it's all connected. And I do not buy, I worked in aviation for 22 years, including on 9/11, and I do not buy the myth that if we don't keep putting hundreds of billions of dollars into the defense budget, we will all be at risk. I say, take some of that money out, there's plenty of it. There's $1 trillion of waste in our federal government, and solve the problems that we have here at home, including in District 21.
Rather than continuing our ongoing failure of war policy in the Middle East, we can use resources, intelligence, and lives from the military and elsewhere to help create the shift we need. The military is one entity that does fully acknowledge climate change and its impacts. And just as I envision Newark 21 as an example of effective, tangible change to represent for the rest of the country, we in the U.S. can use our assets at home to create an example of needed and tangible change for the rest of the world.
So twice since taking office, the current president of the United States...
I think one of the things that the military has been able to do is identify climate change in a nonpartisan way. That's an opportunity that we have. The military has actually identified climate change as an issue, and embedded in your question says that. The military has talked about climate refugees. The problem is that we, as a first world nation, are contributing to climate change, and yet we are not accepting refugees. We are contributing to the destabilization of other countries in the world, but we are not accepting the refugees, like in Syria. So what the military can do is lead, potentially, the charge of, like, the Army Corps of Engineers, cleaning up, using all of the power that they have to do, as we might say, to do good, to help us, right, with the environment and to clean up the damage that might be done. Norfolk, Virginia, as you spoke about, is the rising sea levels, $1.8 billion. $1.8 billion right now if we were to solve the problem of the water encroaching. That doesn't include the military base. That's not Miami. So we know it's going to cost a lot of money, and we know that we have issues with managing our money. We have to face the facts, and then we have to invest in those solutions. That's the solving of the problem. And the military has, because they have, not in a nonpartisan way, been able to identify climate change, we need to allow them that opportunity to speak to science, to speak the truth of science. That's an opportunity that we have. Thanks.
False start, 5 yard penalty. So twice since taking office, the current president of the United States has bypassed congressional authorization and illegally, unconstitutionally, and irresponsibly bombed the sovereign nation of Syria. So one of the first things we need to do while we're talking about national security is Congress needs to wrest back control of our national security state from the White House and back in Congress where it belongs. Congress declares war, not the president. So what does that have to do with climate change? Well, if you go back in the history of the Syrian conflict, there was a drought, about 15 years, that caused subsistence farmers in rural communities to have to migrate into cities that were already stressed with infrastructure and were already economically strapped. So after they moved in, it increased political unrest that already existed, because like a lot of areas in the Middle East, there is a sectarian difference between the majority government in Syria versus the population in terms of Sunni or Shia. And we see this happen a lot. This is one of the reasons for the cause of unrest. So people protested, people asked more from their government, and the regime of Bashar al-Assad cracked down on that rebellion and thus precipitated the Syrian civil war. Now, was it the only cause, climate change, of the Syrian civil war? But it was a big cause of the Syrian civil war, and this is why it's very important that we understand that this is a threat multiplier. Everything that is currently dangerous becomes more dangerous in regards to climate change. That's why we have to get off fossil fuels as quickly as humanly possible. That's why we have to take back our role as the leader of the modern world. We sit here in the United States of America, the only major country no longer a part of the Paris Treaty. The United States used to lead on international issues, and now the international community is leading without us. We're also the only other major country in the world that doesn't guarantee health care to all people as a right. I'm starting to wonder whether the definition of major country is going to continue to apply in future generations. This is why we need leadership, and yes, we need to win elections. So you said we needed to take back the House in order to pass a bill. So will you support the Off Fossil Fuels Act then? Will you vote for it?
Yeah, I will. So I could not agree more with the sentiment that it's a threat multiplier. It is multiplying the effects of immigration, climate refugee, as well as food security, in exactly the way that poverty multiplies the effects of addiction, mental health, and so many other issues. Right now, the single greatest threat to a people is access to resources, is not having enough to eat, or to drink, or to provide for their family with. And when people are living in fear of not having enough food, or water, or the ability to provide, they will likely do anything to provide for themselves, for their families, for their communities, and for their country. And that doesn't always look pretty. So we have to face this. We have to be really honest about the fact that there really is not a larger issue at this moment, and that poverty and income equality are not mutually exclusive, that poverty, income equality, and climate change and environmental issues are not mutually exclusive. Everything is combined in this moment. So it is up to, in this moment, the DOE, the EPA, the FERC, and the, the presidents, the whatever it's called, to come together and create a plan. We need a plan to get off fossil fuels. We need a plan to make sure that people are safe and that they are not scrambling for resources and therefore creating situations in which we are less safe and less stable and unable to live harmoniously. It is the greatest threat to global peace and national security.
Talking to a member of the Pentagon, as well as we know in our district, we have some military experts and diplomatic experts to help me learn about this. And there has been a recently released Pentagon report that indicates that over 50% of our bases and military infrastructure are threatened and compromised due to climate change. And that threatens our military readiness, our responsiveness, and it is also with the international conflicts that are escalating because of climate change, it is putting more of our military service men and women in danger. And the 10th Mountain Division in our district is among the most often deployed Army units in the country. And so people within our own districts' lives are being put on the line a lot more. What I would do about this, I would listen to the military leaders for their guidance on how to respond to the military or the national security threats that come about because of climate change. I would also lobby to be on the Armed Services Committee so that on that I can keep front and center these issues of climate change and national security. Defense Secretary Mattis actually does believe in climate change, and he tells us that this needs a broad whole government approach. I would also push to return those regulations that do work. It will be hard, but we must push in that direction. I would push to invest in clean energy infrastructure. And finally, as our population increases because people are coming to join us, we are going to have additional health care concerns. So I will lobby now to take care of our health care system with Medicare for All.
So now the 30-second follow-up to question two. And here's, you can either address each other or anything anyone has said, or comment on how to accelerate the transition toward renewable energy, if you think that's important, and whether nuclear power is part of the solution.
30 seconds.
30 seconds. We can cover it later, too.
Can you
do
it one more time?
Oh, that's fine.
Okay.
A priority globally needs to be shifting to renewable power, and that's going to start with things like not subsidizing a dying fossil fuel industry and pumping them full of government money to keep them afloat. That'll also help out when we have an administration that isn't fully advocating for what they do and start advocating for what is the inevitable future for everyone to have a healthier and more prosperous future.
I agree that we certainly can't wait and we have to act now, but you can't just flip the switch on nuclear power. You can't just turn every natural gas pipeline off, which I know is a really unpopular thing to hear, especially from someone who's protesting Standing Rock and running an investment campaign. However, we have to make sure that our solutions are working for our communities and that we aren't separating people from the environment, because it's a comprehensive plan and transitions are hard, change is pain. But we have to slowly phase one out, or quickly phase one out, while we phase in the answer. So let's be realistic about our approach and what we can do to actually create change in the immediate.
I'll add one more. I'll use my time by adding one more thought on our district, national security and climate change. Fort Drum is on some endangered species. As the climate changes and gets hotter, we are going to have to be addressing that. And that is going to put the base at risk for closure in the next round of closures if the temperatures keep, and we know what the Army base means for our district. Over 1.2 billion in the economy, as well as almost 6,000 extra jobs. Another reason I'd want to be on the Armed Service Committee. Excuse me, I didn't see you.
Three quick comments. One, I didn't say the military doesn't understand about climate change. I said in this administration, they're not going to be allowed to use that phrase. So listen up and you'll see it. Second thing I want to say is that military installations are creating some of the pollution and damage to the environment. And even though they have tons of money, are not being held accountable to fix the problems they're creating. And the third thing, and I learned this all over the place, and it has to do with the role of government, and it's that communities have to have input into the goals. It's not just the role of government and political leaders to establish goals. Communities need to have input.
Was this the question, how are we going to switch to renewables? Yeah, so I worked in Congress on the last attempt at a cap and trade bill, the Waxman-Markey energy bill. We need to put a price on the cost of carbon. We are falling behind the rest of the world. The only thing that's switching us over to renewables right now is just pure market forces. You need to put a price on the cost of carbon. Now, whether that's cap and trade, like we tried to do, or fee and dividend, which is an excellent, aggressive way to drive down carbon emissions, we need to do that, and that will spark a new clean energy economy. Thank you.
So I think we need to transition and we need to focus more on supply side restrictions. We shouldn't put a tax on something until we first stop subsidizing it. And British Columbia actually rolled out a fee dividend program back in 2008. In the years since the tax has been fully phased in, the taxed electricity sources have actually gone up in emissions and not down. And the carbon tax is potentially regressive in that it affects low-income communities more. So I think we need to transition through, number one, ending subsidies, and number two, through stopping the permitting of new fossil fuel extraction and stopping the permitting of new fossil fuel energy plants. I wish we had more time on this one.
I know.
We'll come back to climate.
sometimes he sends me articles. And in preparation of this, he sent me an article, 98% of new energy production is solar and wind in the United States. 98% this year, January, February, new energy production is solar and wind. So I think that one of the things that we have to talk about is not looking backwards at like cap and trade necessarily, but looking forward at the market and the potential that we have. And maybe we can talk more about that. Thanks.
We will, if we have time, come back to many of these issues. There are so many environmental issues. So this is question three. The current administration has made eliminating federal regulations a priority, targeting environmental regulations in particular. Just a few that have been eliminated include sewage treatment pollution rules, rules governing the dumping of coal mining waste, rules requiring braking system upgrades for trains carrying oil and ethanol. This deregulation is being presented to the public as pro-business and therefore good for the economy and job creation. What is your position on the jobs versus the environment framing of regulation issues? And if there is a genuine conflict between jobs and the environment, how do you think we should address this conflict?
Well, I'll start from where I left off. And that is, I think we need to own the frame. The problem is that the Republicans and this administration has framed it as an either or. You are either pro-business or pro-environment. We are both. We are both. We have to own the fight. We have to take over the argument that they have somehow co-opted. And I'm gonna venture to guess that we have a room full of activists here. We're educated. We're talking about it. We're in the room. So we have to also change our language. When I ran against the largest dairy farmer in St. Lawrence County. He referred to me as that girl. He never once called me by name. By the end, when this company, Bion, wanted to move into St. Lawrence County, I went to John Greenwood, the largest dairy farmer, to say, that company is a boondoggle. I need your help and every farmer's help to understand what they are about to do to us and the St. Lawrence River. We have to work together. And in order to do that, we have to sometimes speak the same language. We have to sometimes show humility. We have to be patient. We have to find common ground. It's not either or. We have to own that. That compromise is power, not weakness. This administration is weak. Donald Trump is weak. That's why he acts the way he does. And we need to model that strength. We need to own it.
I just reject this whole premise entirely that they always throw at us. Being good on the environment is good for jobs. It's good for the economy. This is one of these typical scam arguments that they make. How do you think our economy was doing during the time of acid rain? Up in the Adirondacks. Took a big hit. Talk to anybody in Lake George dealing with the E. coli outbreaks. How's that for the local economy, you know, at the south end of the lake? It's not good. What keeps the lake clean? Some common sense rules. It's a totally ridiculous premise that they always throw at us, and we gotta throw it back with facts. Being good on the environment is good for jobs. And that's really what I'm so concerned about, because there's a legislative process, and we pass these big pieces of legislation, Clean Air Act, Clean Water Act. They're being gutted right now in the rules. They're rolling back the rules. And that's all Administrator Scott Pruitt. The irony that this guy is gonna get out of his job because of an ethics violation. What about all the environmental injustices he's committed? It's so ironic to me. It is one of the most lasting effects of this dangerous radical administration. You can screw up a tax bill. We could fix it in a couple of years. You can screw up another thing and we'll pass a new bill later on. You ruin a water supply, that's potentially irreparable.
And the damage is not just on the water, it's on human health, it's on our economy. It all lasts the course of time. Thank you.
So there absolutely is no conflict between rising to the challenge of climate change and creating jobs. I mean, think about it for a second. Currently, the United States of America is 17% powered by renewable energy. Pushing that to 100% is going to take a lot of work. We're going to have to deploy a lot of windmills and a lot of solar panels. We have to build a 21st century modern electric grid, which is an infrastructure project the size of the interstate highway system. It has to be macro and micro. We have to connect large areas so that we can deal with the intermittency problem, so that you might not have the wind blowing outside right now, but the wind's blowing somewhere. At the same time, we need to have a microgrid so that when increased storm activity comes through and we lose those long transmission lines, we have local power generation as a backup so that people can keep the air conditioning running in hot years and the heat going in cold years when storms knock out power. It's gonna take a lot of work. This is gonna take 20 or 30 years of potentially full employment to do. There's an idea being floated right now in the progressive movement of bringing back FDR's second Bill of Rights, namely a right to a job, a federal jobs guarantee. I'm waiting for the legislation, but if it is directed at deploying renewable energy, at fixing our grid, there's gonna be work for 40 years. That's not just jobs. That's careers. That's $15 an hour plus. That's healthcare. That's benefits. That's consistent. That's union representation. And this is the other thing that we have to talk about, which is when we create the jobs, we need a just transition for the fossil fuel worker. Because when the coal mine closes up, that worker needs to get a job installing solar panels, needs to get a job rolling out wind or modernizing our grid, because it's not the fossil fuel worker's fault. They just want to put food on the table for their family. It is the executives, it is the CEOs, and it is the politicians that should be paying for this, not the workers, and that's why we have to have a just transition for workers.
$64,000 per person. So don't tell me that environmental regulations are bad for business. Right now, especially when we look at offshore wind, we have an opportunity to power the entire Eastern Seaboard while putting people back to work. Those are thousands and thousands of jobs. Wind, just here in the state, has created 146,000 jobs in the last year. So this premise is something that I also reject. And when I think about rolling out a jobs program, I do look to New Deal era programs. I look at the Civilian Conservation Corps. And there's a way to do that now without spending as much money, because the private sector is drooling to create those jobs too, because they know that that's where their sustainable future is. It's something that helps everyone. It's good for business, it's good for people, and it certainly does not have to be an either or. But we have to frame it correctly. And we do have to talk about it with facts. We have to have data to back our ideas up, and we have to figure out how to pay for it. So this is where we roll in the private sector. And the person on the other side of the aisle that's saying, okay, well, that sounds great, kumbaya, but how the hell are you gonna pay for it? We have answers, and we can talk about this in real time, and we can give people dignity back. Think about the dignity gained when you have purposeful work, and that is what we need in New York 21 right now.
Well, there's a lot of agreement up here, so I agree. It's a myth that it's jobs versus the environment. It just isn't. That's why there are so many cities and towns and corporations and states and other countries that are setting goals for 100% renewable energy. There's a business case for that. It's not just good for the environment. It doesn't just create jobs. So I think we're all in agreement about that. I want to say a few words about how we transition to a green energy and a green environmental future. And There's like two parts to it with something in the middle. So one part is these big plans and these big laws that say we're going to have this huge infrastructure investment, and it's all related. It's green energy, it's sustainable housing, it's green transportation near sustainable housing, it's healthcare for all, or some version of public health that reaches everybody. It's all connected. So those are the grand plans that cost money, but as I said, $1 trillion of waste in our federal government. The other part of that is, how do we serve the people that are in dire need today? In this district, there are probably 100,000 people living in poverty. They're hungry, their kids are hungry. How do we create those jobs that can serve them right away? My dad was in the Civilian Conservation Corps. I have these weird pictures. And decades later, my son, after he stopped being a steward for an off-campus conservation program, went into AmeriCorps, and it's an incredibly well-designed and brilliantly trained program. And I have talked about that both AmeriCorps and the clean energy programs and Job Corps could absorb at least 200,000 people nationally and probably 10,000 people in this district. These are phenomenal, well-developed, well-trained, well-managed programs that we could take advantage of right away.
It's not a choice between either growing our economy or saving our environment. The decision is, do we save our environment and grow our economy, or do we kill jobs and kill our environment? You know where my choice stands. It would behoove us at this point to review on a regular basis regulations, make sure they're not outdated, make sure there aren't any unintended consequences that have come from them. But by and large, on balance, it would be a big mistake to see it as a choice between business and the environment. We'd be paying a price with good jobs, we'd be paying a price with businesses and tourism, property values would sink, and we'd be squandering an opportunity to create more jobs. And I know this is where my vision of 10 to 15 years from now, we are the model for a clean energy economy in a rural area. I know it's possible because I've done it. And I had the pleasure, my staff and I were visiting, it was right here in Queensbury that I was able to help with Apex Solar. We visited them this afternoon. 5 years ago, when I was with the Economic Development Organization, we knew that community members wanted solar. We knew that solar companies were struggling. And so we stepped in with some seed money from the state government to bring these two together. And since then, so this was a public-private partnership, since then, over those last 5 years, jobs at Apex Solar have grown by 100. So they were at 30 then, they are now at 100 now. And to keep their business growing, they are going to start partnering with the local BOCE system in order to train our graduating seniors. And isn't that what we need, to give them good paying quality jobs to keep them here? It's possible, and we can do more of it, and that's why I want to go to Congress.
All right, so the attempt to deregulate at the federal level is simply a last-ditch effort to protect dying industries. These measures are only pro-business for the people buying our politics. Eliminating these regulations also eliminates jobs and ignores the fact that the renewable industry is increasingly providing more and more jobs each year. We need a transformational shift in our economy out of the 19th century and into the 21st, and the government needs to help lead this shift.
So now the follow-up, question three. Are there some specific environmental regulations that we should pass to help folks in the 21st Congressional District, or some we should be very careful to keep or address the other?
Well, first and foremost, we do need to maintain the Clean Power Plan to prevent the return of acid rain to the Adirondack Park. That's tremendously important, and that alone is a reason why Lisa Bonnick shouldn't be reelected. In terms of regulations, supply side regulations that we need. We need a moratorium on any new fossil fuel extraction in the United States, and that includes in the Arctic. We need to stop the permitting of any new fossil fuel energy generation. No more new gas-fired power plants, no more new coal-fired power plants, no more permitting on that. And we need to remove the subsidies from fossil fuel companies.
Any of the protections, slash regulations, but protections is more palatable in many areas. Any of the protections that help curb fossil fuels, we need to keep, because they are the contributors to acid rain. We hadn't been talking about acid rain for 20 years, and now, thanks to the incumbent, it's back. We also need to make sure that we maintain any regulations that help us cut down on invasive species. Invasive species stamp, that's not going to do it.
You know, I'm just going to tell everybody, I'm just having this moment where I'm just like, this is amazing. I was watching the forum back, it was interesting, the first forum we did was it was at ACC back in August, I think. Look at how everybody's grown. And I was shocked. I give everybody a round of applause on the stage. And the fact that we feel the people who want to talk about the environment. We just need a good Democrat in Congress. And I think that that's going to happen this year. That's going to protect the environment. So thank you guys.
How we feel about the environment in terms of conflict between jobs and the environment. It's a myth, and I feel like everybody is saying great things, so I'm done. Thank
you. I'm gonna, you know, that, why doesn't everyone give themselves a round of applause? Things work so well. Why don't you all just give yourselves a round of applause again? Because I don't have anything else to add. I think everyone up here is pretty much working this.
Wally, you get to stand up now. This is Wally. Wally is a colonel, a retired colonel in the Army, and has been coaching me. And in his way of preparing me, he made a list of all of the things that the government is now undoing. And so I said, I'm going to print that for everybody. So we put it on nice paper, but we have some. I hope you've picked it up. There isn't a regulation. There's a plethora. This government right now, this administration, is single-handedly undoing the last 30, 40, 50, 60 years or more. And we don't have time. We cannot wait 20 years. We do not have time.
Thank you.
Well, I'm inclined to book my 30 seconds for another question. However, the Green Party was not invited to those last two candidate forums, and it's rude to assume that a corporate-funded Democrat will be the next congressional representative in Taiwan. And so, again, about solutions and how you actually make all this stuff happen. I said there's the big infrastructure stuff, there's real-time jobs for people that are really desperate, and in between is a strategic plan with timelines and roadmaps and a transition plan that touches all the different agencies involved in each issue.
Question four, moving right along. Public lands across the country provide natural resources for our use, recreational opportunities, and sanctuaries for wildlife, among other things. Unfortunately, public desires regarding the use of such land often conflict, and such conflicts have led to polarized positions. The current administration's proposal to reduce the Bears Ears National Monument by 90% is just one example. What are your priorities for the use of public lands, and how would you deal with the conflicts?
So people have wondered why throughout the course of this campaign I have stressed the issue that none of us should accept corporate PAC money as Democrats in this primary. And it was for this moment right here. Don, are you accepting any corporate PAC money?
No.
Tedra, are you accepting any corporate PAC money?
You know what? I actually find it.
Emily? Emily?
Oh.
Dylan's not, Katie's not.
Pat, I'm like rejecting this. I think it's like pomp and,
No, the point that I was going to make is that a corporate-funded Democrat will not be the next congressperson in this district because none of these people are going to accept that kind of dirty money. And the Green Party is going to have to come up with another talking point to try and steal votes from us in the general election. So, in regards to public land, yes, we need to protect and preserve public land. Something dastardly has happened in this country where conservation has stopped being conservative. You know, the original national parks came out of the Republican Party, came out of Teddy Roosevelt as a great conservationist. So what has happened to the conservationists and the conservative movement as we are rolling back the use of public lands in this country? We have to protect those lands. We have to protect the wildlife, especially as population continues to grow. So yes, I'll bank the rest of the time.
I actually would like to apologize. I find the challenge insulting. I have been a legislator, and I've served every person with dignity. Whether or not they gave me a dime, or whether or not they gave me $10 to help me run. Some of you have given me money. I am honored. Some of you have not. And I will serve you. That's what it means to be a leader. The reality is we need to undo Citizens United. And we need to focus on that. And I think grandstanding is something that our president does, and I do not think is something that we should do. Now, the question at hand, the Adirondack Park is a fantastic example, an amazing example of what we can do with public land. We live in the park, and we have businesses in the park, and we are successful in the park. Do we have arguments? Yeah, that's why we have groups that get together. We have environmental groups, we have business groups. I just went to the local Adirondack local government conference talking about how do we further those businesses that are in the park. So when we look at our national forests, our national land, we often talk about it as an either or. Again, getting back to the either or. And we can really follow the model of New York State and the Adirondack Park as a way of looking at the way we can live and function, survive, thrive in a beautiful area. I think there's a lot of work to be done, and I got off a little bit there, but I apologize. Thanks.
All right, I want to take down, smooth it out a little bit. Why I think national parks and state parks, like our amazing experiment in the Blue Line, are so important goes to the fact that environmental issues have been so deprioritized. They don't really pull very high. They're on the back burner for most people. And it makes my heart break when I think about that. And I think about the reasons for that. And we live in this modern era. We spend more and more time looking at a screen, sitting at a desk, not connected to the land like we once were. And I want to tell you how I became so embedded in these environmental issues. Like, my grandfather was a farmer at Farm and Half Moon. My dad was an avid fisherman and made me an avid fisherman. I just life that I spent outside, fishing with my dad and working outside, tied to the land, and that developed that passion. Now the reason I mention that little upbringing is because the national park system and parks in general help reconnect people to the land. And it's so important, because when you do that, when they have those opportunities for recreation and for reinstilling the importance of taking care of our land and being good environmental stewards, that moves the issues up the list. It reconnects people to the land. And that's one of the best things we can do. It will have benefits for generations and generations to come, and that's what I want to have happen. And that's why we have to have a very, very strong national park system. Thank you.
I'm not feeling very well this evening, but this topic makes me even more nauseous. Interestingly though, the greatest steward of public lands in this country has been the United States government. And that's what we need to get back to. They have kept our lands safe by keeping them in a public trust that has allowed all of us to have access, and all of our children, and children to come. And right now, if we were actually going to be fiscally responsible, we would be expanding access and use of public lands, because it employs more people than coal, the outdoor recreation industry that is, it employs more people than coal, natural gas, and oil combined. And people actually spend more money on it annually than electronics and automobiles. So if we want to be responsible, let's look at the numbers. If Trump wants to run the country like a business, you might want to take a second look at the balance sheet. But I'd also like to broaden this conversation, because it's not just public lands, it's also overuse in the Adirondack Park, hiker parking. It is also mineral extraction in the desert. And what we have to do to reach solutions and come up with a way to solve solutions and enhance and bolster communities is to work with the people in those communities and make sure that we aren't leaving people behind. So again, these issues are solvable, but we must make sure that we're including all voices at the table so that we can make good decisions.
Continuing to treat our national treasures as disposable liabilities is a grave mistake. Preservation of these natural and additionally creates jobs and massive amounts of revenue for the government. National park tourism alone generates tens of billions of dollars in the United States. We have already reduced species biodiversity by more than half worldwide, and this is a trend that will inevitably be hugely consequential to humans. We have to reduce the threats and risks imposed upon our Earth and treat it as the invaluable sustainer of life that it is.
Well, I don't want Tedra Cog to be the only one who said that Mr. Nelson's behavior was grandstanding and insulting. And I do believe that one of the women on this stage will be replacing Elise Stefanik in November. And it's not just an issue of corporate funding. There's a new survey that said 3/4 of Americans are giving up on politics because they believe the two-party system is corrupt. New York State ranks 41st of the states in voter participation. Voters, they're not voting. So I think that we all have to reach beyond the traditional talk and be honest with ourselves about what's going on with our party. Means have its issues too. And figure out how to talk to real people about real issues. And it goes back to what I said before. Good government policy, which is rare, requires the participation of New York State residents and the American people. You can't make good public policy in a vacuum. And there's example after example about the failures of government when it didn't listen to we the people. And how we use our public lands is one of those issues, because I've been all over and it's a lot. I love this place. I'm choosing to live here. A lot of it works really well. There are pieces of it that don't. And the further west you go, the more people have issues about how public lands are treated and how they are kept away from public lands.
plans.
I wrote an article with someone who doesn't believe in climate change. And we ended up talking about common ground, and we made a list of our shared vision and the actions that we could take. We have to bring in people that don't necessarily agree with us and don't even use the same language.
I'll start by speaking to the environmental land use conservation equation in our district, which we manage very well. I would like to work, and I support the Adirondacks Association of Villages and Towns and their 2018 legislative agenda, which I'd like to be able to help them implement. We need more broadband. We need more cell coverage. And if Elise had been paying attention to that, instead of pushing a health care bill that would have decimated us, she would have been pushing her party to form an infrastructure bill instead. But turning to the federal level, this is more than an environmental issue. This is another case of the federal government focusing on taking assets and putting them to those people who already have for the benefit of a few and taking them away from the rest of us. That is what this is also about. This federal government is taking these lands, giving them to the state, and the states are already putting into place legislation that will allow the states to give them to companies, wealthy individuals, so that they can be developed. And the amount of money that goes into these local economies from this tourism, $646 billion. 6.1 million jobs are at stake for this. Now, fortunately, again, here in our district, we don't have to worry about that. Our local leaders, our state leaders, we are good stewards of the earth because we know that as our environment goes, so goes our communities. So I look forward in Congress to continuing the partnerships that our local governments are already creating in order to grow our economy by working with the environment rather than with against it, for the good of everyone, for an economy that works for all of us.
So, short follow-up for question four, and you can address this question or any of the other things that have been mentioned. We know, as several of you have said, that rural economies often significantly benefit from tourism on public land. Yet such tourism increases as land becomes more accessible. This happens in the Adirondacks, where, as several of you have mentioned, there are serious issues of overcrowding. How might we address this tension?
I'm happy to have this because my brother is actually the town supervisor in Keene and working very intimately with hyper-parking issues and overuse issues, and it's something I'm very familiar with on a personal level. And I believe the answer is marketing. We need to direct people into underused and underserved areas of the park while also bolstering those communities economically. You know, if we can not just direct people there, but also make sure there's broadband and that their cell phones maybe work so they stay overnight and, you know, buy some food and, you know, have a reason to stay, it's gonna be much more beneficial for all these local communities and the Adirondacks as a whole.
I think Katie hits the nail on the head. It's marketing. We have a park that's over 6 million acres. Everybody's going to do Cascade on the weekend or Algonquin or right. You know, we got to spread out the wealth. A lot of that is tied to marketing and making sure that people know the wealth of opportunities within the Blue Line. And there's a lot that can be done with that. I think there's some infrastructure components too, to making sure that certain parts of the park are more accessible, that certain uses are more accessible. And it's a balance. We got 6 million acres to plan. Let's spread the wealth. Thank you.
It's not grandstanding to ask that candidates for a federal office take a leadership position on the fundamental reason that our government can't get anything done. It's not grandstanding to ask that Democrats in this district stand alongside Senator Kirsten Gillibrand, Senator Bernie Sanders, Senator Kamala Harris, Senator Elizabeth Warren, Randy Bryce, and other leaders that are making this movement possible, that we get the corporate influence out of the Democratic Party. Elise Stefanik held the town hall in Moreau, where she said, "Her contributions don't influence her votes." The entire room laughed. I begged a little bit of time. If you are asking to believe that someone can take money and not be influenced by that money, you are asking to be deceived.
Thank you.
I do think that something we... I do think that something that we should re-explore, and I know it comes up every few years, is the idea of a fee of sorts within the park. Now, I am very conscious of what I said in my former answer. So I think that as we explore it, let us make sure that anyone in our entire district, especially if they have children, no fee. Because that is where children learn the benefit of the outdoors.
I think one of the ways that we can manage is to invest in the upkeep of those trails. So when I was a legislator, we had a youth conservation corps. Because we just don't have the money for it, for many reasons, one of them is Medicaid and our property taxes, we can't manage it, we don't have a youth conservation corps anymore. So I think that we could change how we're funding our taxes and locally and invest that money into a youth conservation corps so that kids, young people, can start working again. Clean. Oh, yeah, pass. manage the trails.
It's important to keep in mind that District 21 is losing population, that we are getting slightly older, that's possible, and we absolutely have to do something to attract younger families. I live in Spring Lake, and I think I've talked to just about every small business owner in that town. And we, guys at small business, feel left out. We do not feel part of the conversation. And small business owners, even if when you drive, the one thing I hear is when you drive up the Northway, you don't even see what's in these small towns.
I agree that marketing and education are definitely important things. We've become very separate from this earth that we are so intrinsically a part of, and everyone's drawn to it despite that fact. So it's very important that we learn as human beings how to reintegrate into the earth and peacefully interact with it, whether it's going to parks or working on renewables or whatever it may be that we need to do to have a more healthy and productive future for ourselves.
And now the fifth question. We're going through some pretty significant issues and really appreciate everybody's attempt to keep it crisp. According to the United Nations estimates, there will be approximately 9.6 billion people living on Earth by 2050. 2 billion more people than today. Some scientists are calling our age the Anthropocene because humans are having a dominant impact on ecosystems around the planet. How should Congress be anticipating the impact of future population growth and its effect on biodiversity and the ecosystems that support human life? What kinds of legislation or other initiatives might be necessary to address these effects? Question 5.
I'm hopeful that through innovation and intellect, we can figure this out. And hope is a blessing, and it's not something that the evangelical far-right side that Elise Stefanik quite often sides with has. We have it on our side, hope. So let's keep it. This is an issue of population control, which leads us right to reproductive rights. And President Trump just reinstated the gag rule. And that means that millions of women overseas are losing access to contraceptives. That is unconscionable. We need to invest, particularly in low-income areas overseas, in programs and services that will allow for voluntary family planning in those areas. That is what women want, and that is what families need. And let's not forget, in our own country, continuing to support Planned Parenthood. Is to protect wetlands, because those may be the food and those may be the medicine for generations to come. That sustains biodiversity. And finally, that intellect that I mentioned, let's invest in public education again. That is what is going to create the stability that we need. So let us pay teachers what they're worth. Let us put assessment into the hands of the teachers. They are the professionals. They know what is best for their teachers. And let us make them, keep them responsible for our children's destiny, because they are doing a darn fine job.
Feed off one another and create a surplus rather than a deficit. Our current systems mine resources and natural systems as if they are infinite and are leading us down a path that can only end in destruction. We need to prioritize the well-being of our planet and the entirety of humanity. The great destruction of ecosystems, plants, and animals must stop, and we must shift to an understanding of living with and through the natural systems that give us life.
I'm feeling incredibly ill and may actually need to exit the stage at some point here in the next little bit. I would just like to comment that it is, you know, undeniably true that humans affect and climate change in general is going to have traumatic effects, you know, both economic and social around the world. And it is our job to keep warming under 2 degrees if we want to have somewhere to live and if we want future generations to have somewhere to live. And the best way to do that is to regulate emissions and greenhouse gases. So what we must do is employ a carbon tax, and it does work. I mean, yes, you have to decentivize, but you also have to tax in order to not incentivize. I mean, they're one and the same. And the regional greenhouse gas emission programs are wonderful on the state level, and it's great to see New Jersey and Virginia coming in to play ball, but it's not enough. These patchwork solutions around the country are not enough, which is why we need FERC to come in and Congress to act to create federal legislation that actually produces the kind of regulation we need and puts a carbon tax out there, because it's the smartest and the most effective way to bring everything back where it needs to be for us to have a livable world. I have a minute left. Life on Mars? I don't know. I mean, yeah. I'm going to defer the rest of my time to respond to something a couple other people said earlier, before and hopefully without having to run to the bathroom.
So this is a touchy subject when you start talking about it's a touchy subject when you start talking about population control, population growth, because it reminds people of things like the Chinese one-child policy and things of that nature that are incredibly restrictive upon personal freedom. But I think Emily said it beautifully. Number one, it is the empowerment of women worldwide to make their own reproductive choices, but it's also economic development worldwide that helps support people. When people are economically secure, when they have access to healthcare, water, food, resources, when they don't live in stress situations, they opt by themselves to choose to have less children. This is why we have to rejoin the Paris Accords and begin investing in these countries to allow them to develop to a renewable energy economy. And we also have to stop the economic hitman. We have to stop foreign development through debt that is a means to extract resources from the third world that does not invest in the third world and keeps people in cash-strapped and desperate situations that leads to more bursts and it leads to more consumption. So it's through fair, humane investment that actually values the human beings worldwide and doesn't just value the human beings that live here in the United States, that we can deal with the issue of population without restricting the freedoms that we've come to know and love and the ability for everybody to make their own decisions in regards to their family. So that's what we need to do.
Brazil is a great example of why or how, not why, but how population is changing. And it's through soap operas. It's through soap operas. It is because people have access to watching TV, and they're watching soap operas, and women are educated and are having fewer children on the soap operas. And in fact, what is happening is that women are having fewer children because of that. It's called soft power. It's called access to TV or education. When women are educated, and I agree with Emily, when women are educated, but also when they have access to birth control, and also when they have access to health care, then they're able to make those choices. They're able to work. When they're able to work, then they will make choices not to have as many children. It's the cycle that we want to support and perpetuate. So that is one thing globally, I think, is that we can and should be kind of leaders in that soft power when we share. And you know, does anyone remember Dallas? All over the world, people watched Dallas. And so that's an interesting thing, because these are the kinds of cultural changes that we have an opportunity to further. Let me see, I want to look at my notes, because I actually had a couple things here I want to talk about. Oh, and it was, if you look at legislation from the last 60s, 70s, we have not had new legislation on the environment since 1990. We are stuck. And so we need climate change legislation. And that's really the last thing I wanted to say about this question. Thanks.
I agree with a lot of, most all of what Emily, stop. And what Ginger said. It was hard to hear Katie down here. So I'm not gonna repeat it. I wanna talk about something else. There's a lot of pain in this country. There's a lot of pain in this district. There's a lot of anger, but under that is a lot of pain. And it's true for our veterans, it's true for our men and women in uniform. It's true for children and families that have been caught up in the abuses of our foster care system and family court, which is a whole other issue. It's true for people in our district that can't really afford to keep a roof over their head and are making decisions every day about food or transportation or heat. So the hard issue is, how do we balance taking care of people here in District 21 with being an honest broker on the international stage and having realistic and transparent decisions made about international development? And I think some of that anger in this country and in this district, because I listen a lot, is because the messaging is, we're going to take care of everybody else out there, and you know, you'll get yours sooner or later. It's not working. People are losing interest in politics. They don't. When I started as a presidential candidate, 19% of Americans trusted government to do the right thing. Hello, it's 3% now. You know, cockroaches do better. There. It's a balance. It's all connected, as we keep saying, education and health and the environment and military policy and foreign foreign policy and economic development here at home and around the world. It is all connected. We have to be really clear about the language that we're using and making sure we understand the pain here at home.
Thank you.
So the question's about really two things, population growth and biodiversity. That was the second part of the question, biodiversity. And it's great to hear the responses. Here's an interesting fact for you. It took millennia to get to 1 billion people on the planet. It wasn't until the beginning of the 19th century. Then it only took about 115 years to get to 2 billion, okay? To get to 3, it took 30. And then since then, we've been adding about 1 billion people every 10 to 15 years. That's what we're dealing with. Now, it's incredibly important that we assist in development across the world, because as a country develops and they have access to healthcare and contraception and education, the fecundity rate drops down. So that's why that's such an important part in curbing population growth. It is vital. We can do it. We have to assist countries around the world in developing and having access to basic fundamental human rights. Now the second component, biodiversity. You can value biodiversity, having however many species we have on this planet. For the sake of that, I certainly do, but it's tied into many things that affect our daily lives, like our ability to grow food, okay? So legislatively, what should invasive species. And invasive species have all sorts of threats. I went to forestry school to study something that was originally from Asia. It was called Hemlock woolly adelgid. From Asia. You know where it is now, as of this year? Prospect Mountain. All sorts of unforeseen consequences, and we can promote and protect biodiversity by addressing invasive species, making sure there's resources to prevent. Because if there's more people on Earth, there's more commerce, there's more mixing of things in shipping crates and ballast water. So we need to go after invasive species. And my last point, I could talk about this forever, I'm sorry, we're running out, but how we're growing our food. Huge monoculture all over the country. What happens when a pathogen or a pest gets in that event? You're wiped out.
Thank you.
We need to promote diverse agriculture. Thank you.
We have about 8 minutes left, and rather than do a follow-up question on this, what I'd like to do is to have each candidate have a minute to just either address something you haven't addressed that you're passionate about, or sum up your views for us. So 1 minute to each, and we'll use the order from question 6.
I want to take my minute to address something, a couple of things that were said earlier, and not in an attempt to undermine my fellow candidates, but in an attempt to have an honest conversation about policies that we may or may not actually be able to employ or may or may not actually need. Two comments were made about overuse in the Adirondack Park. The first was from Emily about installing a fee, and the problem with that is that then you have to staff collection sites for the fees, and with a 2% cap on local taxes, you can't do that. So this is an issue that's been discussed for a long time, and there's not a solution involving a fee that's feasible yet. The second was to Tedra's point of youth conservation program. Well, we already have ATIS. Maintenance of the trails is not an issue. Between the DEC and ATIS, that's covered. And so what we need to do is redirect people, because you know this is an important issue, and I just want to make sure we address it correctly.
Thank you.
And an informed way.
My name is Emily Mars. I live in Saranac Lake, and I would like to earn your support and your vote on June 26th. And so I want to put a fine point upon what an opportunity our district has by focusing on clean energy and protecting our environment. I know that we can't implement in Congress standards, protections, regulations, whatever you want to call them, until we're in the majority, but I am really optimistic that we are going to be in the majority come the end of 2018. And once we implement these parts
carbon, fossil fuel standards, that is going to break open all sorts of opportunities in our district. For example, heating. There is already a geothermal heating company in Ballston Spa. And if we were required to switch over to non-fossil fuel burning furnaces, that would mean a whole lot of new jobs in this district for us, instead of us sending it outside to companies that don't reside in our area. Thank you very much.
There are two things I would like to say from here. How many of you went to see Elise Stefanik recently? How many of you heard her say that she would get rid of Pruitt?
Yeah.
Here we are. Every single one of us can say we care about the environment. Elise Stefanik says she cares about the environment. Actions speak louder than words. The opportunity we have right now is to get rid of Elise Stefanik. And the only way to do that is to use her words and her votes. Every single one of them against the environment. Every single one of them against healthcare, and every single one of them against her own district that she's supposed to represent. I would like to represent you. I have lived here for 30 years. I have made Northern New York my home. I have lived my environmental values. I have served my community in healthcare and education, and I hope to do so in Congress, and I'd like to say thank you for tonight and for being able to speak with you.
I would just like to say what a treat this was for me tonight. I think everybody got the sense I love talking about these issues. I've spent my life trying to be a champion on the environment, whether it was as a forester, as a student, forestry student, or working in Congress as a legislative aide on environmental policy. Right now, trying to take care of our community so that our kids have clean water, so that we finish the job in cleaning up some of these pollution sites. And that's what my life is all about, and I would be honored to be able to do that for you in Congress. You know, I worked in Congress when we were working on the last climate change bill, and we got it passed in one house, one chamber, but it failed in the other chamber of Congress. It would be my honor to be your representative and get back into Congress and finish the job and finally address climate change and clean air and clean water. So thank you for being here. I appreciate it.
Well, I'm not in the June 26th Democratic primary, but I do expect you to send the best woman forward to meet me in the November election. This is simple. You want to demonstrate to the people of District 21, the voters and visitors, that you care about the environment, that you want to transition to green energy, send a green to Congress. You want to demonstrate to the rest of the state and the rest of the country, you want to send a message to Washington, D.C. and the world, where the Green Party is the largest political party on the planet, make history. For the first time in the history of the United States of America, send a green to Congress. And not just any green, they call me the government mechanic, send the government mechanic, send the green mechanic, vote green, make history, and nothing magical about everybody up here on the stage. Run for office. Run for office, all of you.
I'm doing ready. I think we can agree that there's a lot of uniformity in the room about how to address these problems. Pick any issue and we're probably going to agree on most of what we're talking about. And we know the solutions exist as well, whether that's creating an infrastructure bank to invest in all of these projects, or whether that's starting to work on renewable energies, or whatever it may be, the solutions exist. But first and foremost, you're going to have to address, acknowledge, and fix the broken political system. And we all have to come together, not only in this room, but outside of this room, even across the aisle at times, to come together and figure out how we together can all fix this. Thank you for inviting us tonight. It was a great pleasure to be here.
So we're living in a crisis moment in human history and in United States history. We don't have time to waste, we don't have time to lose, and we must take immediate action. But with crisis also comes opportunity. For Northern New York, New York's 21st congressional district, we're likely to experience a longer growing season while we lose farmable land nationwide due to increased flooding, sea level rise, as well as higher temperatures. This means there's going to be increased demand on the agricultural products that come out of New York 21. That's why we have to invest in our infrastructure here, to make it easier for our farmers to get goods to market, because we're going to be feeding the broader Northeast region in generations to come. And we need a member of Congress that will build a coalition with the Northeast region that understand that the constituents in Connecticut, Massachusetts, Vermont, New Jersey, and Pennsylvania, just like the constituents in New York 21, like to eat food. And we are going to be the breadbasket of the Northeast in the coming years. And this is why we need to send someone to Congress with a vision and that will work to solve these problems. I hope to earn your vote on June 26th. Thank you.
I don't know about you all, but we have learned a lot here. And we so appreciate the wisdom that you all have shared with us. But most importantly, the sense of hope and inspiration that you have all brought. Thank you again for being here, and thank you so much for running.